فادعوا بها وذروا الذين يلحدون في أسمائه سيجزون ما كانوا يعملون.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Page 6. We begin today's lesson. We're discussing the names Al-Alim and Al-Khabir. Al-Alim, the all-knowing, Al-Khabir, the all-aware. He is the one whose knowledge encompasses all the outward and hidden matters, the open and secret, all those things that must necessarily occur, all those things that are possible to occur, and all the things that can possibly occur, of the affairs of the whole of creation, of the past, the present, and the future. There is absolutely nothing that is hidden from him. Verily Allah, with him alone, is the knowledge of the hour. He sends down the rain and knows what is in the wounds. No person knows what he will earn tomorrow, and no person knows in what land he will die. Indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the all-knowing, the all-aware. And likewise, the verse on page 7, O mankind, we have created you from a male and a female, and made you into nations and tribes that you may know each other. Verily, the most honorable of you in the sight of Allah is the most God-fearing of you. Indeed, Allah is the all-knower, the all-aware, al-khabir. The name Al-Alim occurs in the Quran some 157 times, and this is one of the frequent names that occur, and it is derived from the root word Alima, which means to know, Ayn Lam Mim, Alim, which means to know. There are other names within the Quran, Al-Alim, like Alim Al-Ghaybi, Al-Shahada, Al-Alim, and you have Al-Lam. The basic word that we use to refer to someone who has knowledge of something, we say he's an alim. Hence this is a word we use to refer to scholars or people of knowledge. An alim. The more intense form is alim and allam. Okay, so the more intense form we use the names al-alim and allam. Now, knowledge is something which all human beings have as well. So this is one of the names of Allah, where by the attribute of his name is partially shared with creation. Okay, so there are other attributes like this, like seeing and hearing. Human beings also have that quality. However, there are a number of differences between the knowledge of Allah and the knowledge of human beings. From amongst them is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows without having the need to be taught. That's one major difference. Human beings, in order to have knowledge, they are taught. There's nothing in this dunya in which a person has knowledge of something except that he is taught with it. Maybe there are certain exceptions to that, such as man's natural disposition, natural fitrah, to recognize and to incline towards the oneness of Allah. That is a type of knowledge, although we don't call it knowledge. It's a natural disposition. Otherwise, knowledge is something which is acquired. That's why Rasulullah he said, إِنَّمَا الْعِلْمُ بِالتَّعَلُّمُ. Knowledge is gained essentially through learning. But the knowledge of Allah, as we said, the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is eternal in the sense that he always knew what was going to occur and what will occur. It is for this reason that when a human being, develops in knowledge and he increases in knowledge, this should actually add to his humility and not to his pride and arrogance. This is because the more knowledge you gain, the more a person should realize how ignorant they actually are. Because when you gain a piece of information, you realize, I actually didn't know that before. So that means previously to gaining that knowledge, I was actually ignorant of the matter. And that's exactly what Imam Shafi'i used to say, that the more knowledge I gain, the the more I realize how ignorant I am. So actually knowledge should be a humbling experience. Gaining knowledge should be an experience which is very humbling. But if it is not, if you don't take into consideration the default state of man, then it could make a person become fooled with his knowledge. And that's what we see today with many people. They become fooled by their knowledge, and they think they have amassed so much information and knowledge, and therefore they have no need of religion. And that's what we see today in the secular world today. They look at religion as a backward way of life, something which opposes science as we know it today, so they think. And that breeds arrogance and pride. And you know, just watch or listen to any debate between a Muslim and an atheist, and you can see that quite evident in not just the ideas that they hold, but the way they carry themselves. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in many places in the Quran stresses the reality of man, that he is someone who is jahul, he is someone who is ignorant. Allah says about the question that was posed to Rasulullah, they ask you concerning the spirit. They ask you concerning the nature of the soul. قُلِ الْرُوحُ مِنْ أَمْرِ رَبِّي. Say that the soul is from the affairs of my Lord. وَمَا أُوتِيتُم مِنَ الْعِلْمِ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. And you've only been given a small amount of knowledge. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions to Yusuf, وَفَوْقَ كُلِّ ذِي عِلْمٍ عَلِيمٍ. And above every person of knowledge, there is someone who is عَلِيمٍ, greater in knowledge. So no matter how much knowledge you have amassed, there is always someone greater, and in reality, that which you know in comparison to that which you do not know, it's far less. You might have amassed a lot of information, but believe me, the things that you do not know are far more than the things that you actually know. So this is one major difference between the knowledge of Allah and the knowledge of creation. A second major difference is that the knowledge of human beings is subject to error and subject to forgetfulness. Whereas the knowledge of Allah is correct, it's all correct, and it's not subject or it's not susceptible to any form of error or misjudgment or forgetfulness. وَمَا كَانَ رَبُّكَ نَسِيًّا. And your Lord is not somebody who forgets. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also knows the future, whereas we can only know what has happened in the past. We can predict what happens in the future, maybe, but we cannot be certain what will happen in the future, whereas Allah knows exactly what will happen in the future. In fact, one of the first things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created was the pen. And this pen, it wrote down everything that will occur until the Day of Judgment. This is reported in Sahih Muslim. Rasulullah said, كَتَبَ اللَّهُ مَقَادِيرُ الْخَلَاقِقِ قَبْلَ أَنْ يَخْلُقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ بِخَمْسِينَ أَلْفَ سَنَةٍ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He decreed, He wrote down everything that what would happen amongst creation before He created the heavens and the earth by 50,000 years. قَالَ وَكَانَ عَرْشُهُ عَلَى الْمَاءِ. And the Rasulullah said, and at that time, the throne of Allah was upon water. The throne of Allah was upon water. So Allah, He knew what was going to happen. So even 50,000 years before He even created the creation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had decreed, and He knew what was going to happen in the future. Now, I'd like to draw your attention to a very important topic when it comes to the knowledge of Allah, and that is the issue of qadr, fate. Now, fate is a difficult subject to deal with because it's considered to be from the secrets of Allah that we do not really have much knowledge of. And that's a golden rule. Whenever it comes to discussion of fate, qadr, or qadr, and qadr, we don't know the essence of it. So our knowledge of it is very limited. So we can't really speak about it in great detail. But the ulama and the scholars, they have looked at the evidence from the Quran and Sunnah, and they have realized that there are certain, you say, pillars. Okay, pillars in Islam, we have pillars of qada and qadr. The first pillar, if you believe in these four pillars of qada and qadr, of fate, you essentially have a good understanding of what fate is. The first pillar, and if you understand this pillar well, you're almost there, or more than halfway there in terms of understanding the reality of fate. And that is the knowledge of Allah. The knowledge of Allah is considered to be the first pillar of fate. Meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows exactly what will occur in the future. And the fact that Allah knows what will occur in the future, it doesn't mean that He has forced us to do certain actions and He stripped us from our free will. To give an example of that, I'm sure all of you went to school and you all had predicted grades. Now those predicted grades were given by your teacher who has knowledge of your capabilities as a student. And so he predicts a grade, but it's something that will happen in the future based upon his knowledge. So imagine, for example, he has two students. One student, excellent student. His student comes to class on time, does homework excellently, always does, you know, past papers really well, in mock exams, gets 100%. So the teacher, what's he going to predict? That this student will get an A or a B, or maybe A star. Yeah? Definitely pass at least. Another student hardly comes to class, and when he does come, he's always late. Okay, and when it comes to mock exams, it's terrible. The teacher is now going to predict that this person is going to get a fail. Now, the exam day comes and they, you know, they get their results. Obviously, the one who's predicted to pass extremely well, the one who's predicted fail, you know, he fails. Can the one who fails come to the teacher and say, "Why did you make me fail? You predicted that I was going to fail. That's not fair." No one can say that. Just because the teacher predicted doesn't necessarily mean that he forced him to fail. And this is where the confusion lies with many people. People think, oh, if Allah has decreed everything, what's the point of us doing anything? If Allah knows we're in paradise, or we're going to be in hellfire, what's the point of doing anything? No, just because Allah knows you're going to paradise, or He knows that you're going to hellfire, doesn't mean He's forcing you to do anything. لِمَنْ شَاءَ مِنْكُمْ أَنْ يَسْتَقِيمُ As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, that this is a reminder for who? For those amongst you who wants to be steadfast. So Allah has given us free will, but this free will is obviously governed by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is what we mean by saying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He has knowledge. He knows everything that will happen in the future, but that doesn't necessarily mean He has stripped us and taken our free will away from us. We all have free will, but as I said, that is within the guideline, within the decision of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَا تَشَاءُونَ إِلَّا أَن يَشَاءَ اللَّهُ رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ And you do not will anything except unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills it. So you can will something to happen, but if Allah doesn't decree, it will not happen. Okay, and there are other pillars of faith. Secondly, we say it's the Allah's Kitabah. Allah, He writes down everything that will happen. And this writing down, there are various different ways it's written down. It's written in the Lawh Mahfuz, the sacred tablet. There's other stages in life where things are written down, like when the soul is born into the body. Okay, and then the third pillar is that of Allah allowing that matter to happen. This is Allah's will. Allah allows it to happen. And fourthly, Allah creating the action. And when we mean creating the action, meaning He gives you the ability to do that action. So Allah, at the end of the day, if anyone does an action, physical action, he needs the power, the strength, etc. to do it. Allah gave him that ability. So these are the four pillars. And obviously we can go into great detail about these four pillars, but I just quickly wanted to mention the first point in some detail about the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, if a person realizes that Allah knows everything that will not just happen in the past, but that which will happen in the future, unfortunately there were some deviant sects in the past that believed that Allah only knows that which will happen. Sorry, Allah only knows that which happens in the past and that which is happening now, but He doesn't know what will happen in the future. There was a deviant sect of that belief, and there was another deviant sect that believed that Allah only knows things in generality and He doesn't know specific things. Again, that's another deviation due to some influence of Greek philosophy. But we don't really need to go into life. I don't think there's anyone here that has those beliefs. And we believe Allah is everything that will happen in the future, and He knows everything in great detail. The first point, the first benefit that we develop from knowing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Aleem, the All-Knowing, is that it instills in a person a sense of haya of Allah, a sense of shame. As one of the scholars used to say, هَلْ أَبْكَاكَ عِلْمُ اللَّهِ فِيكَ. Has the knowledge of Allah about you ever made you cry? Has the knowledge of Allah about you ever made you cry? What does that mean? That Allah already knows. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala already knows what our fate will be in the hereafter. And Allah knows whether we will die from iman. He knows whether we will enter into Jannah straight away, or whether we need to be punished in the hellfire first, or whether we will spend an eternity in the hellfire. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala already knows it. Imagine a person sitting next to you knows your fate in the hereafter. How would you be in front of that person? And we are embarrassed when people know our hidden secrets. But if someone knew our end result, where we would be in the hereafter, then we would find it extremely difficult to look at that person in the face. Because that person could be looking at you and he knows that you're going to die upon kufr. You're going to die upon sin. And can you look at that person in the face like that? Extremely difficult. And therefore the believer has this awe and has this sense of haya, sense of shame in front of Allah, because he knows he is worshipping someone who knows what his end result will be. And this also, and this is the second thing that leads to a sense of muraqabah. Muraqabah is a sense where a person knows that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is observing him. Always recollecting that feeling and that emotion and that knowledge that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is constantly watching you. This is what we call muraqabah, and this is the first level of ihsan. أَن تَعْبُدَ اللَّهَ كَأَنَّكَ تَرَاهُ. It is to worship Allah as if you see Him. Because you know Allah is Alim, He can see, He knows everything. And therefore, because it instills a person a sense of muraqabah, it also acts as a major deterrent not to commit any sin. For many of us, you know, we probably can, if we think we can avoid being captured or being caught doing something wrong, we'll probably do it. Now this is a society where CCTV cameras are everywhere. I think in fact UK, there was a statistic that showed it has the most CCTV footage in all of Europe. And I think that reflects a lot about the state of society. Because what's the need of having CCTV footage? Because people think that, you know, if there's not a camera looking at them, then they can go and commit a crime. But when your heart is attached to Allah, when your heart is attached to Akhirah, you don't need CCTV camera. Because you know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is aware of what you're doing. You know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is aware of what you're doing. That's why Aisha radiallahu anha, she said, if the first thing in the Quran that was revealed in the Quran was, لا تشرب الخمر, don't drink alcohol, no one would have listened. The first thing in the Quran that was revealed was, don't zina, no one would have listened. Everyone could have committed zina and drank alcohol in their homes. You know, it would have been a simple issue for them. However, the first thing that was revealed in the Quran was the Surah Al-Mufassalah. Yani, and these are the surahs from Surah Qaf, chapter 50 to the end of the Quran. In these chapters, you find the remembrance of the paradise and the hereafter. And then, when the hearts became attached to the hereafter and to the Quran, etc., then that's when the halal and the haram came down. And this is a major problem that we find amongst the youth today, where we find that. I'm sure many of us, well, you know, the parents amongst us, maybe sometimes we find our children to be very rebellious. You tell them to pray, you tell them to fast, they don't listen. That's not going to work. Telling people to pray and fast, just leaving it at that, it's not going to work. You have to make their hearts attached to the Akhirah. You have to make them aware of the consequences of their deeds. If they don't fast, they don't pray, what will happen? Do they really believe in the hereafter? Do they really believe that there is a concept of hisab, of a reckoning? When that is strong in the hearts of our youth, that is when they'll be able to adhere to the religion. And that's the task for us, really, to attach our hearts to Allah and to the Akhirah. And believe me, if we achieve this, implementing the halal and the haram would be easy. And that's why when the prohibition of alcohol was sent down, the streets of Medina were flowing with alcohol. We didn't have to, you know, the Muslims didn't have to send around enforcement teams to make sure that people weren't drinking alcohol. No. Everyone did it willingly because they knew Allah was aware of their actions. Also, another, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَعْلَمُ مَا فِي أَنفُسِكُمْ فَاحْضَرُوهُ As in Surah Al-Baqarah. Know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala يَعْلَمُ مَا فِي أَنفُسِكُمْ Know that Allah knows what is within yourselves. Allah knows what you hold within your hearts, what you hold within your minds. فَاحْضَرُوهُ Therefore, be warned of Him. Be warned of Allah. And this shows you the benefit of knowing that Allah is aware of our actions, of our faults. فَحْذَرُوا So therefore be warned of Him. Another important benefit of knowing that Allah is Al-Aleem is that it consoles the believer when he suffers calamities. It consoles the believer knowing that Allah is Al-Aleem when you suffer a calamity. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَا أَصَابَ مِنْ مُصِيبَةٍ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ No affliction befalls upon you except with the permission of Allah. But then Allah said, notice this, many of you probably heard this verse. Allah then says, وَمَنْ يُؤْمِنْ بِاللَّهِ يَهْدِ قَلْبًا And whoever believes in Allah, Allah, He guides his heart. وَاللَّهُ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٌ And Allah is the knower of all things. This is in Surah At-Taghabun. So again, pay attention. مَا أَصَابَ مِنْ مُصِيبَةٍ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ You are not afflicted with a calamity unless with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then he says, وَمَنْ يُؤْمِنْ بِاللَّهِ يَهْدِي قَلْبًا And whoever believes in Allah, Allah guides his heart. That just seems like a sudden shift in discussion, but actually they're very connected. Imam al-Tabari mentioned in his tafsir, the explanation of his ayah, And he said, هو العبد تصيبه المصيبة This ayah refers to a person who is afflicted with a calamity فَيَعْلَمُ أَنَّهَا مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ And so he knows that this calamity, it comes from Allah فَيَرْضَى وَيُسَلِّمُ And so he is content with that. He believes that this is from Allah and he willingly accepts this decree from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So again, مَا أَصَابَ مِنْ مُصِيبَةٍ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ So whoever is afflicted, no calamity strikes except by the permission of Allah. وَمَنْ يُؤْمِنْ بِاللَّهِ Whoever believes in Allah, in what aspect? He believes that this is a calamity that has come from Allah or a test from Allah. It is a musiba from Allah. When he knows this, يَهْدِي قَلْبًا Allah, he guides his heart. He guides his heart such that he can deal with this calamity and this trial and difficulty in the most befitting way. You need that guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be able to deal with calamities in a right way. You can't just deal with it by yourself. You need the support of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and those who when they are struck with a calamity, قَالُوا إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ They said, indeed we belong to Allah and to Him we shall return. These are the people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showers with His mercy. But the condition is, you must know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is aware of your musibah. Allah is aware of the hardship that you're going through. If you know that, then you know that whatever Allah decrees is for a wisdom. Don't think that Allah has left you alone. He knows what you're going through, and He's allowing it to occur for a wisdom. He's allowing it to occur for a wisdom. So if you suffer a trial or difficulty in life, don't think that you're there by yourself. No, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. And when you know that Allah knows, this is what gives you tranquility in your heart. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Anfal, الآن خفف الله عنكم وعلم أن فيكم ضعفا. Now Allah has lightened the burden for you, for He knows that there is weakness with you. Allah knows, علم أن فيكم ضعفا. Allah knows there is weakness in you, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made things easy for you. Allah also says, فَعَلِمَ مَا فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ. Allah knew what was in their hearts. فَأَنزَلَ السَّكِينَةَ عَلَيْهِمْ. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent tranquility upon them. Allah, He knew what was in their hearts, and so He sent tranquility upon them. So we must realize that when we go through hardships in life, Allah knows. And when you know, Allah sends tranquility upon you. The best example of that really is in the cave when Rasulullah was fleeing with Abu Bakr. And when Abu Bakr, he saw that the Quraysh was so close, he became worried for the safety of Rasulullah. Rasulullah said, لا تحزن إن الله معنا. لا تحزن إن الله معنا. Don't be worried, don't be anxious, don't be scared, don't be sad, for indeed Allah is with us. Immediately after that, Allah says, فَأَنزَلَ اللَّهُ سَكِينَتَهُ عَلَيْهِ. That Allah, He sent His tranquility upon him. Upon who? Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. This verse is actually speaking about Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. It can't be referring to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because the Rasulullah said to Abu Bakr, don't be afraid, Allah is with us. Okay? And this is a great proof which shows you the great virtue of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, that Allah gave him sakina. If Allah gives you sakina, there is nothing that can criticize you thereafter in your life. So, فَأَنزَلَ اللَّهُ سَكِينَةً وَعَلَيْهِ. When did Allah send His tranquility? When Rasulullah reminded him, إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَنَا. Allah is with us, meaning Allah's knowledge of our situation. And that's when the sakina descended upon him. So the equation is, when you go for a trial or difficulty, but you equip that with your knowledge of Allah, that He is aware of your circumstances, Allah will give you sakina. Allah will send tranquility upon you. It's easy saying this, brothers and sisters, but believe me, try and implement this. When you go for a trial or difficulty, when you're suffering from hardship, just sit there, remember Allah. Allah is alim. Allah knows what I'm going through. وَاللَّهُ لَا يَبْتَلِي لِيُعَذِّبُ. Allah, He doesn't test people to punish them, وَلَكِنْ لِيَخْتَارُ. Rather to test that person. Another important bit, moving on now to a different sort of topic. Now, we spoke about knowledge before. We spoke about knowledge before in the sense of humans are only given knowledge through learning. We should therefore realize that knowledge, it comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is very important. Knowledge, beneficial knowledge, it comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is a gift from Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَيُعَلِّمُكُمُ اللَّهَ. Have taqwa of Allah, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will teach you. وَاللَّهُ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٌ. Allah is knowledgeable of all things. As the Surah Baqarah, verse 282. عَلَّمَ الْإِنسَانَ مَا لَمْ يَعْلَمْ. Allah, He taught man that which he did not know. He taught man that which he did not know. What did the angel say when Adam was first created? سُبْحَانَكَ لَا عِلْمَ لَنَا إِلَّا مَا عَلَّمْتَنَا. Glory be to you, you are free from imperfection. We have no knowledge except that which you have taught us. إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَلِيمُ الْحَكِيمُ. Indeed, you are the all-knowing and the all-wise. وَعَلَّمَ آدَمَ الْأَسْمَاءَ كُلَّهَا. And Allah, He taught Adam the names of all things. Everything. Therefore, we should realize that knowledge, it comes from Allah. Beneficial knowledge, it comes from Allah. And this is from the du'as of Rasulullah ﷺ. Allahumma inni as'aluka 'ilman nafi'an. Oh Allah, I ask for beneficial knowledge. And not just knowledge, but beneficial knowledge. Because there's a lot of knowledge there that doesn't benefit us. And that's why he needs to seek refuge in Allah from knowledge which didn't benefit. وَأَعُوذُ بِكَ مِنْ عِلْمٍ لَا يَنْفَعُ. I seek refuge in you from knowledge which doesn't benefit. وَأَعُوذُ بِكَ مِنْ عَيْنٍ لَا تَدْمَعُ. And I seek refuge in Allah from you, from an eye which does not shed tears. وَمِنْ نَفْسٍ لَا تَشْبَعُ. And from a person who, I seek refuge in you from being someone who's not content, essentially, of what is given to him. وَمِنْ قَلْبٍ لَا يَخْشَى. And from a heart which is not in awe and fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He needs to seek refuge in Allah from these matters. If we realize, therefore, knowledge is something which is a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we should be quick to attribute this knowledge, obviously, to Him and realize that this knowledge that we have, it's not simply a result of our own efforts. It's tawfiq from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why knowledge and wisdom, I mean, many scholars will say you shouldn't be envious of anything except for two things. Wealth, in which a person uses to spend in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You can be envious of that person for that reason. وَرَجُلٌ أَتَاهُ اللَّهُ. And a man who Allah had given him hikmah, wisdom. And so he judges between people, and he judges between the affairs of people with this wisdom. You can be envious of that person. Obviously, on condition you don't wish that is removed from that person. You know, you wish you had the same as the person, that's fine. This also, knowing that therefore knowledge is a gift from Allah, should lead a person to have love for knowledge. العلم, because it's from Allah, a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it should make a person have love of knowledge and its people. And it should make a person strive to attain this knowledge. It is something which is beloved to Allah. Allah dislikes jahl. Allah dislikes ignorance. But Allah, He loves knowledge. And this is why Allah praises the people of knowledge in so many places in the Quran. And Rasulullah will praise the people of knowledge in so many places. Now, when we love knowledge, though, we need to understand the reason why we love knowledge. Now, the human soul is naturally inclined towards amassing information. Naturally, every human being likes to gain information. Muslim or non-Muslim alike. And this is why we have to be very careful when we seek Islamic knowledge. Why are we seeking this knowledge? Are we seeking this knowledge just to satisfy this instinct that we have to amass more knowledge? Sometimes when you learn a hadith, you might learn, you know, sometimes people attend a lesson, and the only reason why they attend it is for that, you know, the ooh and ah and subhanallah factor. Ooh, subhanallah, what an amazing hadith, what an amazing ayah. And that's about it. It's information for them. It doesn't go beyond that. And that's why I always say, whenever you attend a circle of knowledge, whenever you attend a lecture or a course, you can intend it for a number of different reasons. And the first primary reason, which I find to be quite common amongst people, and Allah knows best, people attend circles like of knowledge for entertainment. Entertainment. Okay? Secondly, a level above that, for information. Thirdly, level above that, for knowledge, for beneficial knowledge. These are the three reasons why you can attend a circle of knowledge. What were they? For entertainment? If that was the case, that knowledge is not going to benefit you much. Okay? It's not going to benefit you much. You probably get hyped up in that lecture a few hours down the line, withers away, and you come back the following week waiting for your next video. Okay? And unfortunately, knowledge has almost been portrayed like this. Knowledge is now being unfortunately portrayed like this, especially in the Western world. You won't really find this in the Muslim world. Knowledge in the Muslim world is not considered entertainment. Okay? The greatest scholars, if you were to listen to their lectures in the Muslim world, old men, big beards, white beards, and they're speaking in this way, very slowly. For many people, you know, if they were to sit in that lesson, they'll fall asleep. But if you see their students, they're wide awake writing everything down. And their hearts are being nourished with this knowledge. But now, we can't listen to people like that. I mean, personally, I find some of those beneficial lectures in English. You know, the English might not be brilliant, they don't have that flair, but their knowledge is something else. I mean, take for example, Sheikh Idris. This man is one in a million. And the fact that he speaks in English, it's just amazing. A lot of people, though, when they hear, I mean, many of you, I mean, how many of you even heard of Jafar Sheikh Idris? Okay, maybe some of you have. A lot of you probably, if you have heard of him, you probably don't listen to him. Why? He might not be the most prolific speaker, but subhanAllah, this man, I believe, if people had his knowledge, the Muslims in the West would be in a different position. Really. Knowledge is not just about, when you attend circles, it's not just for entertainment. No, it's to benefit you, to transform your understanding of the religion and your life in this dunya. That's what knowledge is meant to do. And this is the knowledge that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves. That's the knowledge that Allah loves. And that's why you should seek refuge in Allah from knowledge which shouldn't benefit. And that's something that we don't fear, unfortunately, enough of. We don't fear that. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam feared that. He sought refuge in Allah from knowledge which didn't benefit. For us, it doesn't really matter. We just want to go and enjoy ourselves. Be careful of this. Now, I could be addressing different people. I mean, probably amongst you are those who hardly attend Islamic circles. And so maybe, you know, you haven't even thought about that level ahead where you want to really transform your life by this knowledge. For some of you, it's just a thing you're doing a Sunday afternoon. But I don't want you to view knowledge like this. You know, really understand that knowledge is meant to transform you. It's not just for you to listen. And that's why I always say, whatever science, whatever thing, whatever, you know, discipline I teach to people, I always say, learning takes place outside the classroom, not in the classroom. The classroom environment is for you just to take in the information, but then the knowledge is meant to blend with your soul, your blood and your flesh thereafter. And that can only happen when you take that information, you reflect over it, and you act upon it. And the students that I've seen succeed in life when it comes to Islamic knowledge are those who do that. They don't just attend and sit, participate in the lesson, that's all. They go back, they think, they reflect, and they try and act upon that knowledge. Since knowledge is a gift from Allah, knowledge deserves its respect. Knowledge is ihtiram. The people of knowledge have respect, they deserve a high level of respect. And that's why the ulama of the past, they were extremely serious when it came to teaching knowledge. Imam Malik, rahimahullah, when someone used to stop him, and someone asked him about hadith, he would say, wait, sit down. And he will sit that person down and then he will narrate the hadith to him. He disliked narrating hadith standing up. Another scholar, he saw one of the students laugh in his class. He got up and he walked away. Why? He said, why should I teach people that do not respect knowledge? And you know, so many things that happen. You know, I mean, I see, and you know, I'm used to seeing that. For example, people sending text messages. You know, people using their phones in the middle of a lecture. This is su' al-adab. This is bad etiquette. With the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So really, give knowledge its honor, its and respect it. Imam Ahmad, whenever he used to teach, he used to go wearing his best garments, best perfume he used to wear. Because when you have, when you revere knowledge, you revere everything related to it. When you revere knowledge, you revere everything related to it. One thing I cannot stand as well, and I think is extremely disrespectful, and I say this especially to sisters, because in many cases when there are brothers teaching sisters, obviously the speaker doesn't know what the sisters are doing. So sometimes they come and they bring in food, and this is extremely disrespectful. At least have respect for the knowledge. No individual person would demand respect from another, you know. A person should be humble. I'm not going to say, you know, give me respect and honor me, okay? But at least have respect for the knowledge. At least have respect for knowledge. Okay. The next name, which is Al-Khabir, I think probably we'll take a break now, actually. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله أما بعد الخبير it's a name which is fewer times in the Quran 45 times it's very similar to the meaning of al-alim the only difference is al-khabir pertains to knowing hidden matters or knowing the more intricate details of a matter. That's why in someone who's khabir amongst human beings, we say he's an expert. So a khabir is an expert of something because he knows the ins and outs of the a particular science or field or matter. Khibra, we say khibra. Khibra to refer to experience. We say khibra in Arabic, that means experience. Why? Because a person knows the reality of that matter. He doesn't just know the matter without experiencing. If you know a place, for example, you know it exists, but you've never been there, you have knowledge of that place, but you don't have khibra of that place. You have knowledge because you've been told about the details of it. Khibra, though, would entail you know the intricate details. It means you've actually been there. You've seen, you know, the nooks and crannies of that place. So that's why when khabir is used in the Quran, in most cases it is used to refer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knowing that which is within our hearts, knowing that which is on our minds. I mean, if you look at the second verse that he quotes on the top, page 7, if you look at the last sentence of that verse, verily the most honorable of you in the sight of Allah is the most God-fearing of you. Atqaakum, the one who has most taqwa. Indeed, Allah is the all-knower, the all-aware, the khabir. And where does taqwa reside? At-taqwa ha-huna. Taqwa resides in the heart. No human being knows what is in another person's heart. In fact, sometimes you don't even realize what is within your own heart. And that's the case for most of us. We know certain things that are in our heart, but there are many things that we do not know what resides in our heart. Envy, hatred, jealousy. Sometimes we're not even aware that we have riya in our hearts. We show off in our deeds. Sometimes we are unaware of that. So, khabir, it's, as we said, the same meaning essentially as al-alim, but it pertains to the more intricate matters. Therefore, the most important benefit of knowing that Allah is khabir, a person becomes more attentive to the actions of the heart. A person becomes more aware and attentive in regards to the actions of the heart. Actions of the heart are very, very discreet. Sometimes we don't know. That's why Rasulullah said, "Dabba ilaykum da al-umami min qablikum al-hasadu wal-baghda." There's a disease from the previous nations is creeping up behind you. When you say creeping up behind you, what does that imply? You don't know what's coming to you. Al-hasad wal-baghda, envy and hatred, envy and spite. But these are diseases that we can't always detect. Showing off, ar-riya, or sort of describe it as sometimes being like a black ant on a black stone in the middle of a dark night. Do you think you can see that black ant? No, you won't be able to see it. It's that discreet. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He will judge us not just for the outward actions that we perform, but He will also judge us for what is in our hearts. And this usually raises many questions. Does Allah take us to account for the faults that we have? There's no simple answer to this. It's a yes and a no answer. In certain areas, yes. In certain areas, no. I mean, the obvious ones are your intentions. If your intentions are sound, Allah will reward you for it. If your intentions are bad, Allah will punish you for it. And that's a matter of the heart, isn't it? So Allah will judge you for what is in your hearts. Well, not everything. Like a fleeting fault, for example. If it's a fleeting fault that you're going to commit sin and it's just passed by your mind, no. Allah will not judge you for that. But He will reward you, for example, if you make the intention to do a good deed. So imagine you said, tonight I'm going to perform Qiyam al-Layl. I've made that intention. You get reward for that intention alone. What about if you decide to change your mind, like before you go to sleep, you think, actually, you know what, I had a really hard day, let me just sleep until Fajr. You still get reward. For the intention, not for the action, but for the intention. If you do the action, then you get more reward. Obviously, if you overstep by accident, you still get reward as well. If you overstep. Sins do, on the other hand, is slightly different. If you change your mind, and this is amazing, subhanAllah, imagine you intend to make a sin, you intend to commit a sin, you intend to go and stab someone, then you turn around and you say, no, inni akhafullah, I fear Allah. You're saved from the sin, but in fact you get a reward now, because you've intended to stay away from that which Allah hates. So you get reward. Now this doesn't give you the license to intend to commit sins and then change your mind later, so I can get some reward. No. Because you don't know, once you make that intention, Shaitan could really work on that. And he will nurture that feeling and he will make you go and commit that sin. Okay? Sometimes we intend to commit sin, but sometimes impediments come in the way. Impediments, they come in the way. You can still be held accountable for that. This is why Rasulullah said, "Al-qatilu wal-maqtulu fi an-nar." The murderer and the one who was killed are both in the hellfire. So the Sahaba, they said, Ya Rasulullah, hadha al-maqtul, this murderer, we understand. We understand why he's in the hellfire. Why is he killed? Why is he murdered in a hellfire? Rasulullah said, because he had the intention that had he had the opportunity, he would have killed him as well. So he has two people fighting, not just one defending himself. Obviously the one who's defending himself, he's not to blame. If there are two people intending to kill each other, one will obviously survive. But the one who was killed, he had the intention, but something came in his way. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will punish him in the hereafter for that, and judge him for that. But the worldly rules don't apply. The worldly rules do not apply. So for example, imagine I intended to go and kill someone, and I was ready, and I went to the kitchen to grab a knife, and I intended to stab him. I run into the kitchen, and I do not find a knife. Okay, now can I trial him for murder in the dunya? No. But could he be trialed in the hereafter for murder? Yes. This could happen. So that shows you that actions of the heart are extremely, extremely important. They're extremely sensitive. Imam Sufyan al-Thawri, and I always use his example because it's an amazing example. He said, I was denied praying Qiyam al-Layl for a number of months. Due to one sin that I committed. And what was that sin? He saw a man praying in the mosque who was crying in his salah. He said, this man, he didn't say it, he thought in his mind. This man is only crying because to show off. So that sin, he said, it prevented him from praying Qiyam al-Layl for 40 nights. Some narrations mention 5 months. And we wonder why we can't pray Qiyam al-Layl. The difference between us and Imam Sufyan al-Thawri, he was aware of his impediments. That's why I forgot his name now. Al-Fudayl ibn Iyad. Al-Fudayl ibn Iyad, he said, if you're not capable of praying Qiyam al-Layl, and you're not capable of fasting during the days, فَعْلَمْ أَنَّكَ مَحْرُومٌ. Know that you have been denied this blessing from Allah because your sins have prevented you. Now you might look to your life and say, well, I don't commit zina, I don't drink alcohol. Well, there are sins of the heart that many of us commit. And that's why really the topic of the sins of the heart and the actions of the heart are extremely important. We don't really realize the significance of it. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-khabir, and the main benefit of knowing that Allah is khabir, as we said, is that the person becomes more attentive, more vigilant towards the actions of his heart. Now, the verses that the author has used here, I want to just maybe reflect over the second verse, because this is a verse which is commonly misquoted. So on page 20, on the top page 7, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O mankind, we have created you from a male and a female, and made you into nations and tribes that you may know each other. And that's where people usually stop quoting the verse. Okay? What does this mean? Firstly, how do people use this verse? This verse is used a lot in interfaith dialogues and interfaith discussions. And they try to use this verse to justify that we are meant to mutually coexist and respect each other's beliefs without condemning one another, without looking down upon one another. Because the ayah says that Allah created us in this way, so لِتَعَارَفُوا, that you may come to know one another. Now the problem with that understanding is that it makes a person think that Islam and Kufr is on the same level. We are all equal. No one has a greater right over another, over the other person. وَمَا لَبَعْدَ الْحَقِّ إِلَّا الضَّلَالِ. But what comes after the truth except falsehood? Islam is the truth and everything else is falsehood. So you treat everything in that light. You do not treat falsehood as the truth. And you do not treat the truth as falsehood. The ayah that clarifies, the scholars that clarify the meaning of this verse, what does it mean that Allah created us into different tribes and nations that we may know one another? Meaning, every tribe has a lineage. Every tribe has a name. For example, how many Muhammads do we have here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Muhammad, that's quite a lot. Or 7, mashallah. Okay? But you all have different surnames, hopefully. Okay? You all have different surnames. Your grandfathers all have I'm sure they all differ in their names as well. And you all have different tribes, isn't it? So Allah created us into different tribes and nations. Why? So you can have your own identity. So you know who you're referring to. Oh, do you know Muhammad? Which Muhammad are you talking about? Oh, Muhammad Fulan, Muhammad Siddiq, or Muhammad Khan, whatever. Oh, I know who you're talking about now. Those people who try to use this verse to say we're all the same, the next part of the verse completely shatters that myth. Look what comes next. Verily, the most honorable of you in the sight of Allah is the most God-fearing. Yeah? The most honorable in the sight of Allah. And what does that establish? That there are different levels. The one who has taqwa, he's honored in the sight of Allah. The one who has no taqwa, he is not honored. لا يستوون, they are not the same. Don't think that the one who believes and who is upon light from his Lord is like the one who walks in darkness. They are not the same. This doesn't mean though, brothers, don't misquote me, and therefore say that we can, you know, abuse those who do not choose Islam and show them disrespect or what have you. No. This is one of the unique things about Islam actually, that although we recognize there's only one truth, there's only one truth and everything else is false, this doesn't allow us to mistreat others. Whereas people of other faiths and other ideologies, anyone that opposes their ideology is usually mistreated or treated in a very bad way. In Islam, we don't believe in that. We believe that you still treat others according to the just rules of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we don't give freedom to people to abuse and to mistreat others. Okay, so that's regards to that verse. We can now move on to the next name, Al-Hakim, the All-Wise. He is the one to whom belongs the highest wisdom, the one who is all-wise in his creating and commanding, who perfected everything he created. And who is better than Allah in judgment for a people who have found faith? Therefore, he has created nothing out of mere frivolity, and he has legislated nothing that is vain and of no use. The one to whom belongs wisdom in the beginning and the end. He has three areas of ruling which nothing else has a share in. He rules between his servants with respect to his law, his decree, and his recompense. These are three areas which we've spoken about before. Wisdom is to place something in its correct place. For those who believe not in the hereafter is an evil description, and for Allah is the highest description, He is the Almighty, the All-Wise. It is He who is the only God worshipped in the heaven and on earth, and He is the All-Wise, the All-Knower. By the way, that last verse proves that the name of Allah has a meaning. The name Allah has a meaning. If you look at it, He is the only true, only God worship. Now here in the Arabic, that He is the Ilah, and He is Allah. He is Allah in the heavens, and He is the Allah on earth. Does Allah exist on earth? Of course not. So what does it mean? He is the Ilah, meaning He is the one who is worshipped upon the earth. So what does Allah mean? The one who is worshipped. Okay, Al-Hakim, there are other names like similar to this, such as Al-Hakim, but when it's used, Allah uses Al-Hakim in the Quran, it's usually in the plural form. Okay? Al-Hakimin, Ahkam al-Hakimin, Al-Hakim, and Al-Hakam as well. Al-Hakam, so we have three names that are very similar: Hakam, Hakim, and Hakim. As for the name Hakim, it occurs in the Quran 49 times. Hakim occurs in the Quran 49 times. And the word Hakim is derived from the root word Hakama. Hakami. Hakama, we derive a very well-known word that we all know probably, Hukum. How do we usually translate Hukum? Ruling. Now, let's just look at how it's linguistically it is used. Hakama literally means to Al-Mana, we say, Al-Mana, to restrict someone or to deny something to someone. But in many cases, it's to restrict and to control. That's why the hijam, or the reins of an animal, in Arabic we call it a hakama. Why? It's because it's through those reins that you control and you can restrain the animal. A judge, one of the names of a judge in Arabic is Qadi, but another name is Hakim. A judge or a ruler is called Hakim. Why? He legislates laws that restrict people and confine people to certain acts that they can or cannot do. And also a judge is called that because they say, لِأَنَّهُ يَمْنَعُ الْخَصْمَيْنِ مِنَ التَّضَارُبِ, because he is someone who, the judge, he prevents opposing parties from being unjust to one another. That's the whole point of a judge. Why do you go to a judge to solve a dispute, isn't it? And when does a dispute arise? When someone has wronged somebody else. So the judge, what he does, he prevents people from wronging one another, and he establishes justice. And that's why the definition, therefore, of hikmah, or of hikmah is wisdom. Wisdom is derived from the same root of hakama. وَضْعُ الْأَشْيَاءَ فِي مَوْضِعِهَا, is to place matters in their correct places. And that's what the author said, wisdom is to place something in its correct place. That's how we define wisdom. To place something out of its correct place, that is what we refer to as dhulm, injustice. That's how we define injustice. Injustice is when you place something in its wrong place. So opposite of hikmah is a dhulm. Okay? Now, what does placing something in its correct place, what has that to do with being a judge, for example? You probably see this, isn't it? I mean, a judge, he has to make sure he passes a correct judgment. If he passes the wrong judgment, or he's given a judgment for putting it in his wrong place, then he's failed his purpose as being a judge, a hakim. Okay? Likewise, if you're trying to control a horse with its reins, and you pull at the wrong time, what could happen? Okay, you'll fall over. Okay, if you're an inexperienced horse rider, you don't know how to. I remember once I rode a horse. About ever being taught how to ride a horse. And I was a bit silly because I asked for a crazy horse as well. And so I said, give me the Majnun one. And so he gave me the horse. SubhanAllah. And this horse, I don't know, I think it was on steroids or something. And he just shot off into the desert. I didn't know how to control it. So I started pulling here and pulling there. And I fell off. And I hurt myself quite badly. So, knowing when to pull the rein is extremely important. Without that, you're going to make a big mistake. So what is wisdom? To place something in its right place. A common misunderstanding of people when it comes to wisdom, many people, when you think of wisdom, you associate with wisdom pacifism. To be passive. Brother, have wisdom. Don't speak. Don't say this. Don't do. Similar to sabr. When someone tells you have sabr, what they think that means is don't do anything, just sit back. So they say the ummah is going through a calamity. We are being slaughtered left, right, and you know. And then people they say, yeah, akhi, have sabr. And the person will tell them, say, yeah, akhi, how can you tell me to have sabr when this is happening around the world? Sabr doesn't mean that you become docile and you just sit there and don't do anything. Likewise, wisdom doesn't mean that. Wisdom means to place something in its correct place. So if the situation dictates that you are silent, be silent. If the situation dictates that you need to speak, you have to speak. So for example, if someone's committing evil in front of you and you can change it, you have the ability to change it. To keep silent is not wisdom. That's the opposite of wisdom. But if maybe trying to change that evil will lead to a greater evil, okay, then maybe speaking out at that time is not the appropriate time to speak. Rather employ a different means if possible. That's wisdom. Okay? And likewise, sabr doesn't mean that you just sit there, don't do anything. Sabr means you restrain yourself from doing that which is haram, self-restraint. That's the problem. Sabr in English, you translate it as patience. Patience is usually understood as just withholding and not doing anything. No, sabr in Arabic means habs al nafs. It means to restrain yourself from that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't like. And that could sometimes, sabr therefore could be a proactive thing. Sabr is proactive. You have to be doing something whilst having sabr. So if someone says we need to have sabr, even though the ummah is going through a calamity, you say yes. You need to have sabr. We need to have sabr, the Muslims in Syria need to have sabr, the Muslims in Palestine need to have sabr. That doesn't mean just sit back and not do anything. They need to have a proactive form of sabr. So, hikmah, therefore, when we say Allah is hakeem, this therefore means that Allah, He places everything in its correct place. In what areas does Allah place things in its correct place? The author mentioned them here. He has three areas of ruling, three areas of His wisdom. That no one else is ashamed. Number one, he rules between his servants with respect to his law. So his law, his hukum, is a manifestation of his hikmah. Now the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala haven't been placed simply as a test, not just as a test, but as a mercy as well. So many people, they look at the sharia and they see the sharia as a code of do's and don'ts. And the only reason why we have these do's and don'ts is simply as a test. No, but there's great wisdom there, because Allah knows that these rulings, they are best for mankind, they actually suit mankind. Allah legislates for maslaha. Allah legislates for the benefit and the welfare of mankind. That's what we mean when we say Allah is Hakim. He legislates rulings that are best for us. If we don't understand the wisdom behind the ruling, we don't start accusing the text itself, the rule itself, we accuse our deficient understanding. That's why Allah says, كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْقِتَالُ. Allah has legislated fighting upon you, though what? It is disliked to you. Perhaps you like something, but it is bad for you. Perhaps you dislike something, but it is good for you. Allah يَعْلَمُ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Allah knows, but you do not know. This is Surah Baqarah, I think about 200, verse 217, near that. So therefore, the rulings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala suit the needs of man. And it's for this reason we cannot choose another ruling, even though we might think another ruling makes sense. And this is the problem we are faced with today in this society. Because we are living in a different civilization and a different way of life from the Islamic way of life, we are bombarded with contradictions and conflicts in terms of understanding of matters, for example, rights of women. Okay? A Westerner or a non-Muslim will see that, for example, there are different rulings with regards to women, the way we treat women in Islam. They might not like that. But we say, look, Allah is the best decider. Allah is what is best for us. And this is why I always say, whenever you're confronted with a non-Muslim and they challenge you on Islamic rules, don't just try and justify the Islamic rule. This is the major problem. We become very defensive and we say, look, well, there's benefit in this ruling from this angle. Okay? Rather say to them, look, this ruling, it comes from our Creator. From your Creator. You don't have a problem with Islam, you actually have a problem with the ruling of the Creator of the heavens and the earth. What would they say? That's your understanding. That's what you think God says. And this is where the Muslim, this is where he begins to control the discussion. He says, well, then this is the issue at hand then. Because at the end of the day, as a believer, I don't adopt these laws because they all suddenly make sense to me. I believe in these laws because I believe they are the word of God. So, if we want to come to a conclusion about this particular matter of debate, whether it's the hijab or segregation or hudud or what have you, let's discuss whether this book is the word of Allah. Because if it is the word of Allah, you have no right to challenge the decision of Allah, isn't it? I'm sure they will all agree on that premise. That if you say to them, look, if this Quran is the word of Allah, do you have a right to go against the decision of your Creator? Surely they would all say, you know, we can't go against the decision of the one who created us. And that would be foolish for anyone to say that. And that's how we should control the discussion. The problem with us Muslims, we are always at the receiving end. We just receive all the questions. We receive all the questions. And so we end up becoming very defensive and we've been, you know, put into a tight corner. And we become therefore very apologetic in our stance. What we need to do is stronger. I'm not saying we go and start foaming at the mouths and shouting and screaming. No, but just you control the discourse. That's what I'm saying. You control the discourse. Don't allow other people to control the discourse. So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-An'am, verse 140, أَفَغَيْرَ اللَّهِ أَبْتَغِي حَكَمًا. How can I, should I, choose other than Allah as a judge? And who is better in judgment than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for those people who truly have knowledge? There is no one better in judgment. And this is why it is not permissible for any person to contradict the ruling of Allah. To Allah belongs al-hukm. In Surah Al-Qasas, verse 88, Allah says, لَهُ الْحُكْمُ وَإِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ. To Him belongs the commandment, and to Him you shall all return. That means to Him belongs the commandment in all these three affairs. In areas of judgment, in law, in areas of his decree, meaning in what he decrees in terms of life, qada and qadr, and recompense, i.e. who will go to paradise and who will go to the hellfire. These three things belong to Allah alone, nobody else. And therefore, the last two are more or less agreed upon. The first issue is there where there is more controversy today. The issue of the hakmiyyah of Allah, or Allah's right to legislate. If you understand what we mean by hikmah and hukum, then you will understand that in these verses I've quoted, there are many verses like this, the command belongs to Allah alone. Therefore, matters of judgment and pardon, you know, in terms of positions of authority, they belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The halal and haram belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now here, this is in terms of legislation, there's something that we find many people unaware of. When it comes to legislation, not everything that is legislated goes against the hakimiyya of Allah. There are certain things that clearly go against Allah's hakimiyya, His right to passing judgment. For example, if someone starts allowing the selling of alcohol, or you allow riba, interest, this is clearly going against the hakimiyya of Allah. But if someone, for example, wants to set up some administrative laws, like, for example, the traffic lights, yeah? Has a person committed shirk? If he has legislated laws with regards to traffic? Some people today say yes. Okay? This is not shirk. Shirk is when you directly challenge the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, there's no harm, okay, in legislating. Even in Islamic State, we will have traffic laws. Don't know how it will be implemented, but we look at the state of Muslim countries today. But we will have traffic laws, and who invented these laws? They were found in the Quran and Sunnah. These are administrative laws. People can, you know, have administrative laws. No problem with that. There's no shirk in that. Anyway, I don't know about this kind of worms. I know there'll be many other issues, so we'll move on briefly, inshallah. Now, the effects of knowing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-Hakim. Firstly, we've already made note of this, so that the ruling therefore belongs to Allah. Ruling belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. No one has a right to rule other than the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَا يُشْرِكُ بِحُكْمِ أَحَدٍ As Allah mentioned in Surah Al-Kahf, verse 26, and no one can share in the judgment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In al-hukmu illa lillah, verily the ruling belongs none except to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As mentioned in a number of places in the Quran, Surah Yusuf, verse 40, 67, Surah Al-An'am, verse 57. Also, another important benefit that hikmah, it's a quality that Allah He gives to some of His devout servants. Hikmah, wisdom, is something that Allah gives to His devout servants. يُؤْتِ الْحِكْمَةَ مَنْ يَشَاءُ Allah, He gives wisdom to whoever He wishes. وَمَنْ يُؤْتِ الْحِكْمَةَ فَقَدْ أُوتِيَ خَيْرًا كَثِيرًا And whoever Allah gives wisdom to, indeed Allah has given him great deal of good. This is in chapter 2, verse 269. And what do we mean by a person having hikmah? Obviously, this means placing things in the correct place. But this also implies that the person, his statements, his beliefs, his actions, always fall in accordance with the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wisdom doesn't just mean saying words in a very smart way, okay, or being very philosophical. Usually when people are very philosophical, people think, oh, this person is very wise. Wisdom just doesn't lie the way we speak, but it lies in our beliefs and in our actions. That's what we mean by hikmah. That's why they said the person who has hikmah is a person essentially has been given the tawfiq, this divine accord from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to act in the right manner. Another important benefit of knowing that Allah is al-Hakim is that we submit to the commandment of Allah. Whether that commandment be related to legislation, or whether that commandment would be related to fate, we accept the decree of Allah. What's the motto of the believer? Sami'na wa ata'na. We hear and we obey. We do not challenge the decision of Allah. We do not question it. We do not say, is this ruling really befitting for our time and age? No. All of the rulings of Allah are befitting for all times. So on that note, inshallah, I think we will end today's class, inshallah. And next week we will begin by looking at Al-Barr and Al-Kareem. I thought we would discuss it today, but Qadar Allah. So until next week, inshallah.